I beg of you, don't say goodbye. Can't we give our love another try? Come on, baby, let's start anew. 'Cause breaking up is hard to do. So that song that you just heard is Neil Sedakis, and it's an oldie but a goodie called Breaking Up is Hard to Do. And the reason I chose that is because this video is going to be on the China-U.S. relations, and more importantly, where I see the trade war going, and what I see the outcome of this kerfuffle that we seem to find ourselves in. And if you can't tell, it seems like we're going more towards breaking up, which is hard to do, as he mentioned. So more importantly, I want to go over past instances where we've seen the United States breaking up with other countries or entities. And more importantly, I would say what that means for how we should be looking at investments that are related to China. So that being said, I'm going to pull up some information here on the last time that this happened, OPEC, United Arab Emirates, which is basically a conglomerate that up until fairly recently was in charge of a majority of the oil distribution throughout the world. All right, so what we're looking at here is this is a chart of the crude oil prices. And what I want to focus on is this period here from the gray bar on, because this is the Great Recession, and this is most pertinent to our discussion with regards to energy independence and the mirroring of manufacturing independence. So if you look here, we saw oil prices during the early and mid portion of the Great Recession really spiked up. And if you remember, you probably won't remember this part, but it got up about $144, $145 a barrel for oil. But what you saw is, well, at least here locally in Missouri, gas prices around $330, $350, something like that. So it was it cost quite a bit to fill up your tank. If you were outside of Missouri, the price would have been higher or lower. It depends on this is a function, but also of what the cost is, but also how much fuel tax your local state or municipality puts on oil. So, but this is the portion that I want to focus on here, is this 80 to 100 band. And the reason is that during this 80 to 100 band, it became feasible for a technology that was unutilized up until this point, because it was too costly to get oil and gas out of the ground utilizing this. So it's called fracking and horizontal drilling. And so it's been around, like the technology and or the skill, however you want to put it, has been around for a long time. It just wasn't thought to be feasible. It didn't make economic sense. It wouldn't be profitable at these ranges. So once we got into 80 to 100, they said, hey, we may be able to use this. So they started coming online. And so as a result, as they came online, that caused part of the drop. But the other reason is that we saw the economy slowing. And as you see an economy slowing, energy prices tend to go down. And that's because energy is the number one component that you need in a growing economy. Because, I mean, if you think about it, if you're wanting to build things or create services, you need more energy to do that. You use less energy just sitting still rather than moving and doing things, right? So those were the two reasons we saw this come down. And most people aren't aware of this, but that, we'll go to this next chart, that oil and natural gas is a big reason why we came out of the Great Recession at the rate that we did. If you look at the red line, this red line is looking at the employment growth or lack thereof during the different years. And so you can see employment was coming down because the Great Recession was going on. People were losing jobs, so on and so forth. And it started to slowly come back. You saw more and more job growth. Well, during that same period, the blue line, this is oil and natural gas. So remember when I was talking about this chart, they started hiring more people because they thought, hey, we can take advantage of this. And so we see them hiring significant sums of people because they were coming online. So let's come to this last chart here. So this chart's looking at the number of barrels per day of oil. And this chart is looking at the number of, or the amount, cubic feet of natural gas per day that we were producing. And so these are all American companies, US companies. And so if you look really for a long time prior to this too, but on this chart from 2000 to 2008, we really didn't, or almost 2010, we really didn't get over 500,000 barrels a day. And then you see it jump up to over 4.5 million. And we're still up in this area. Same thing over here with natural gas. You see it go parabolic. I mean, it goes from next to nothing to over 40 cubic feet per day. So because of this new technology, we saw an influx of this. So let's come back to this chart. So we see all that energy coming online. And as a result, if you come over here, OPEC doesn't like our energy independence. And the reason they don't like our energy independence is because OPEC predominantly was the one who controlled the spigot. They could determine what the price of oil was because they could either put more money out or more oil out on the market and drive the price down or take some off and drive it up. So as we became more and more energy independent, the belief was that these frackers can't stay in business, or it's not profitable for them to be in business unless they're over in this range or above. So they started pushing the prices down. They were trying to flood the market with oil, believing that they could drive them out of business and continue to be the world's driver of oil prices and energy. But what we know by just the natural order of things is that the more that you do something, the better you tend to get at it. So the more fracking that we were doing, the more employees that they had doing it that were getting skilled at it. So at the beginning, they weren't very good at it. They got better and better and better. And that's why you see in this chart, you see it start going up significantly, because they got better and better at actually getting the stuff out of the ground. So this quickly became unsuccessful. They realized it was going to be unsuccessful because they thought they would be unprofitable in these ranges, but the reality is they're actually profitable in these ranges now. So because their skills were low, and their skills got to this point, they were able to stay in business and flourish. So to bring this point further to home is, think about earlier on in the early 2000s, if there was any, and during this period here, there was any talk of there's a war breaking out in the Middle East, or there's a supply of oil that's going to be an issue, or a pipeline's going on, you would see oil prices just shoot through the roof. Well, now, I guess, consider that to today. We've recently had Saudi Arabia, their main oil fields were attacked, barely any issues. There's talk of war with Iran, barely any issues. I think it's called the Strait of Hormuz or whatever it is, issues that might get shut off, barely any issues for energy. It's because we are so energy independent that this is the case. So let's keep this in mind as we're now going to transfer over to talk about China and the manufacturing independence that that I foresee us moving towards and why that's important.
Okay, we're going to move on from the energy independence, and we're going to see the mirroring in China and manufacturing independence and why that's important for us as a whole, and when we're looking at our investments. So the main issue that we're running into with China in the trade deal is that there is just a fundamental difference in the culture of Chinese companies and how we do business with one another. And the issue is that all's fair in love and war. Well, in China, all's fair in love and war and business. So if a Chinese, if you're in a business deal with a Chinese company, if they're able to take advantage of you or you, them, whatever, it's just viewed as, you got me, you were able to get me, and there was nothing I could do about it. So that's, it's just the way it is. There's no repercussions. There's no court that you can go to say, hey, this wasn't fair or what have you. And the most, I guess, famous example of this was the old CEO or the former CEO of Microsoft. Several years ago, he did an interview or wrote an article and something like that, where he was talking about 90% of Chinese companies use Microsoft products, but only 1% actually pays for it. And he said that because of that, Microsoft has lost out on $10 billion or more of profits that would have come into the company. And that's significant. I mean, that's one company that, you know, lost a significant amount of profit because of that. And what China would probably say is that, well, yeah, because if you made a more secure product that we weren't able to take, then you would have got, we would have paid you for it. But because you didn't, that's on you. And that's just the nature of business. And so where we're at now is we're seeing, we saw tariffs recently get put on these Chinese goods. So Trump and his organization decided we're going to put tariffs on you know, really anything that's a lot of what's being produced in China. And so what that does is that increases the price of those goods and services. So now think back to our energy independent example. As we saw price go up, we saw another technology, another group that was able to say, hey, not the price is at this level, we can produce and we can be competitive. And now maybe in manufacturing, or for them it was oil, now it's manufacturing. So the issue, the only, we'll call it the linchpin that we're seeing is that the skills in China when it comes to manufacturing are at the level of, let's say, this mouse, but the skills in a lot of these other countries, and we'll even include ourselves, are at this paperclip skill. So the skill it takes to make this paperclip is relatively low. The skill it takes to make this mouse is relatively high. So until we're able to get from the paperclip to the mouse, we're stuck with China. We can't manufacture things elsewhere, right? Just like we saw with in the oil markets. We couldn't really deal with, we had to just kind of deal with whatever OPEC did because they held all the cards, right? Well, so this trade war has been going on for over a year now. And countries and companies are focusing on getting from this skill level of manufacturing to this skill level, right? And the time it takes to get from those two skill levels is, let's say, it takes this amount of time. The time it takes for China to change its entire culture and the way that it does business is significant amount of time, because you have to change your entire economy. I mean, almost in very short order, and that's I just don't believe that that's possible to change that much. But teaching someone to create something and getting them skilled at it, we've seen, as we talked about with the oil independence example, it doesn't take that much time for people to get good at something. They just need enough practice at it. And so that's why I don't believe it's happenstance that if you look at who Trump and his delegates have been meeting with, it's been Japan, India, Vietnam, South Korea. So they're meeting with countries that are and trying to make trade deals with them that are close in proximity to China, as well as saying, hey, let's bring some of this manufacturing back home. Because these countries, while you know, it's been going on for a year, their skills are quickly rising. And they have an incentive now because the price is here, the price is up. And so they're looking at it going, hey, China was making how much money of manufacturing. How many jobs did they have in their country, and how much money did they make as a result of manufacturing things for the United States and other countries as well? This isn't just the United States. They see that and they go, hey, because these prices are up, if we get our skills up, we can take that business and we can have all these jobs for our country and for our, and we can get all this money flowing into either our country or our company. And it's just a matter of time until that happens. And so I don't believe that there's going to be enough change that's going to happen in China in a short enough amount of time to keep the companies from moving out. So the two things I would say to keep your eye on are pay attention to news stories that talk about, as you see manufacturing coming out of China, then that's sign number one. And sign number two is if you see talks of the trade war is going south and, oh, there's all these issues and we don't think there's going to be trade. If you see discussions like that happening and you don't see the market going down, you're probably in the process of that happening, just like what we saw with the energy independence. As you see more and more manufacturing independence spread globally, you're going to see less impact on the market because they don't control the spigot of manufacturing. So be weary of companies that are deriving a lot of their business, whether it's creating a good or service in China, or they're deriving a lot of profits from China because they sell to it. I'd be very weary of those companies because I don't see the trade deal, for all the reasons I mentioned before, coming to fruition at all, probably. But the good news is, the more, just as with the energy independence story, the more we get manufacturing independence spread throughout the globe, the better it actually is for everyone. And we, as consumers, end up getting better goods at a cheaper price. So we're going to close on that, and I'm going to let Neil sing us into break. Don't take your love. Breaking up is hard to do. Remember when